Here we are at Gariwerd National Park in Western Victoria with Aruna, or Roony, and he's offered to give us some of his time today to tell us about his background, his people, where we are, the significance of the indigenous people of Australia believed, well, it's pretty much for sure that they're by far the oldest continuously existing human culture. And thank you so much for taking the time. And so tell us a little bit about the name Koori. What exactly does that mean, and where does that come from?
Koori is an indigenous name for within Victoria, some parts of New South Wales as well. They call themselves as Kooris. So Koori was an indigenous name for the traditional owners within this area, or the indigenous name for us. Now, when first whites actually come here 232 years ago, they gave us the name of Aboriginal. Was the name as the European called us today. You go to some parts of Australia, where South Australia, they call themselves Nungas. Here we call ourselves Kooris. Like I was saying, New South Wales as well, known as Kooris. You go sort of more Queensland area, they're known as Murrays. Over in Western Australia, they call themselves Noongars. So where we are in Victoria here, we are known as Kooris.
Is the name Aboriginal, is that offensive at all or anything?
For me, it sort of is, because
sterile.
Yeah, it's that stereotype, and that's what they called us, was a native, or when they first come here, they thought we were feral and walked around little nothing on, barefooted.
Yes.
And we thought we had no idea of survival and living, and they thought we were very, stupid people, I suppose, and that's where that misunderstanding of us being traditional owners of this land, and we lost over 40 to 50,000 years, and we've still got that story to tell, and the non-Indigenous people. So if we could survive over them amount of years, 40 to 50,000 years, it's about time that these non-Indigenous people are starting to realise and respect us and understand us.
Absolutely.
The knowledge that we've lived here for thousands of years.
And your ancestors didn't just survive, they thrived.
That's right.
They thrived without destroying the land.
That's right. We, like I was explaining to you the other day, Jeff, that the way we see Mother Earth, that she owns us, we don't own her. And that's what the non-Indigenous man, the European term, they believe that they own her. But in the day, that Mother Earth, the way we were taught, that Mother Earth owned us. She supplied us with everything, your water, your natural flows and your waterways. Also these plants and flowers and different medicines and herbs and spices that we use in our cooking, and also medicines as well. So the non-Indigenous man had no idea what they were doing to our country. Especially when they took a lot of the trees and down for cropping and ploughing and sheep and cattle, and they're not realising what they've done to the Mother Earth itself. So, well, we're taught from generation to generation that she owned us, we didn't own her. So she supplied us with all these food, tools, weapons that we may have needed, fire, we call it warrel here in Victoria. Your waterways. So there's a lot of ignorance, I think, when white settlement come here. And same thing with the main food source from this area was known as the Murniong, were known as the Yamdays today. And when the white settlement come here, they bring a lot of sheep and cattle. And once sheep started eating the flower of the Murniong, and then saw their cattle sort of trampled the root system, and got wiped out throughout this area. So I just had a gentleman come here this morning, and he's asking me about some of the native plants and why the Western diet and the Western society, the food, is killing a lot of us.
Absolutely.
Not our, my community, but it's the non-Indigenous community as well. But still in my community, the big main killer is diabetes. Now, the reason for that is us Indigenous people here in Australia are actually relying on the supermarkets that we go to today to buy that Western diet food. And that's why I tell a lot of students that come through the Brambuk Cultural Centre here, where I'm education culture officer here, I actually inform young students and also their parents, you know, be careful what we do buy from a supermarket. And I do tell them, when you go to a supermarket, you pick up any item off that shelf, you look at the back of that product, how much fat, how much sugar, how much energy in each item that we rely on from a supermarket today.
Yes, Lisbon and I started she's very sensitive to a lot of these chemicals and stuff, and we after an episode that happened in Darwin a couple of years ago, we started really paying attention to the ingredients, and sometimes we got a thing called a hedgehog. It's like a little brownie, and it had 60 different ingredients. And we started looking up what some of this stuff is, and a lot of them, anything with a 3 number, it can actually be industrial waste that they've disposed of as a food additive.
That's right. Yeah, and a lot of calories and whatnot, and different food that we put for our bodies. So my ancestors roamed this area, and over 40, 50,000 years ago, it was always healthy food, so always hunt and gather, and everything was always fresh and healthy. So when we go hunt kangaroo, we didn't go slaughter everything like the white man did, go on a rampage and shot everything. So in the clans or tribes over here, there's probably been about 30 to 40 in that clan or tribe. So when we go hunting kangaroo, we only hunt what we needed, to survive on. But when we did hunt kangaroo, we used pretty much the whole thing. We didn't waste the roo itself. We call it midge down here in Gariwerd itself. It was a traditional name for kangaroo. So the meat, of course, to survive on. Now, I don't know if you're aware out there, but kangaroo meat's probably the best meat for you because there's a lot of protein and iron. There's no fat on it at all.
And they exercise a lot. They don't just stand there in a feedlot or anything.
That's right. They're out there, they're hopping around all the time. So it's all muscle and protein and iron in it. A lot of other food that we rely on from the butchers and the supermarkets today, a lot of fat and a lot of steroids being pumped into it.
Genetically engineered stuff?
Yeah, a lot of water.
Frankenfoods?
Make it look fresh, you know, it's only been slaughtered a day or a day before.
Well, hey, let me share this word with you that relates to what we're talking about. There was a Native American guy from the Lakota tribe called Black Elk who lived in the 1800s, and there's a book you can read. You might really enjoy it. It's a sad story. He was a medicine man, and he saw his people be destroyed by the white man, and they came, and the name they made up for him is called Wasichu, W-A-S-I-C-H-U, and that's the Lakota word. It means somebody who takes the fat, because the fat was the most valuable part of, like, the buffalo.
Yep.
And the white man would kill it and just take the fat and then leave everything else just laying there to rot. And so the Wasichu is the name I've given to... It's really a mentality of that greed and ignorant, destructive sort of like mentality of that a lot of modern day people have, regardless of the color of their skin. It's a mentality of where they worship money and they'll come and chop down a forest and just kill animals and just hunt something and put it in on the wall of their house and with no respect for the earth at all.
That's correct. Yeah, the same sort of thing happened here, like in Australia as well, say the Native Americans back in Canada and also the States itself. So it's just that lack of understanding and respect of our culture. And here in Australia, we are the oldest race being recorded within the world itself. So it's quite frustrating being an Indigenous man in a white society. And like I was saying before, going back to the Western diet food, and the biggest killer in my community is the diabetes. And the reason for that, because we rely on the Western diet food. And like I was saying earlier on, when we did hunt kangaroo down, we pretty much used the whole thing. So first his meat to survive on, of course. Also his skin or his fur was skinned off him, and that was used for warmth, or better on his clothing that we wear today. Also his bottom jaw bone was removed, and that was used for a carving tool for most of the decorations on their tools and weapons. Also his shoulder blade was removed, and that was used as a knife. It's quite sharp, and that was used to cut the meat up. The other main part was his killie bone. It was removed from the back of his ankle, and that's quite long and very pointy. And that was used as a knitting needle to knit most of our possum skins and make clothes or been on the blankets today. Now, my favourite part was known as a sinew. It's a bit of tender muscle at the back of his tail. So every time we go on our property and hunt a bit of roo, I always take the tails off. And what I do is actually when I do the skin, the skin off him, between the skin and the meat itself, excuse me, it's got these rows of tender muscle, which is known as sinew. Now, sinew is very stringy, like a lacquer band, elastic band. What we tend to use that sinew for is actually made into like a thread or a lace or a rope. And that was used to tie stones onto the handle, so your tommy hawk or your axe head was tied onto a bit of timber. And once sinew dries up, it is hard to break. So the kangaroo, we call it midge here, was very important food in my community. So that's what the main food source was, your kangaroo, midge, and also jawara. Now, jawara, known as the emu today, was a very fatty bird. And that, again, was used for two purposes, the meat to actually survive on, but the fat was actually divided. And that was used mainly for our rock art here in Gariwerd. We're now the European name for it is known as the Grampians, was brought over from Scotland back in the 1850s. Now, what my ancestors would have done with this emu fat is actually smeared it over the top of the image of rock art whilst they painted the image on the stone on the rock. Now, what that fat actually does is actually keep the rock art preserved or lacquered. So you could go away 18 months and come back 18 months later. It looks like you've just done it yesterday. That's the other thing I'm trying to fight for, is actually get our custom and laws back in the southern part of Australia. If you go more central desert, they've still got the custom and laws. They actually take young Indigenous kids out there and teach their oral history from word of mouth, and take young children and touch that rock art up and teach their young moros, our young children, the custom of law. And that's what I'm trying to fight down here in the southern part of Australia, get our custom laws back here before it's too late.
Now, let me ask you this. Could you tell us a little bit about the significance of the rock art and what some of the major sites here are? And I think that you told me that there's over 300 rock art sites here, but most of them are unknown to the tourists, or they aren't allowed access. But tell us what are some of the main ones, and what the, it's, is it, would you say it's sort of like a cross between a library and a temple?
Yeah, you could say that, because the oldest rock art site actually been recorded now has been between 25 to 30,000 years old. The youngest one's been recorded here is in between 10 to 15,000. And as you're saying, Jeff, there is over 300 rock art sites been recorded in the park itself. So we have pretty strong history and custom here. So that's what I'm trying to do, is actually get that custom and law back here before these rock arts actually start fading away.
Vandalised and stuff.
And like you were saying before, there is 300 rock art sites in the park itself being recorded and documented, but there's only five of them out to the public.
What are the names of those?
You got Bundjil. Now, Bundjil is known as the Aboriginal Creator Spirit within Victoria itself, some parts of South Australia and also New South Wales. So it'd be like a god, it'd be like a Buddha. Bundjil was a very important man to our, in our community. So he provided, same as Mother Earth, he created Mother Earth, we believe, down here. So your waterways, you know, your trees, your different plants, your animals, you know, and marsupials and whatnot. So so Bundjil was very, very, very strong in our community, and still is today. So that's what we're trying to do, is trying to teach our young ones before it's too late. And a lot of our young ones are not interested no more. They're too much in a white man society, and technology has taken over now. So that's where my role, I get very depressed and very frustrated for my young ones, because they're not taught the way like we were taught 40, 50,000 years ago. Too much in a white man's society. That's what the white man's got to realise, you know, how important our customs and laws are.
Yes.
And we've got to pass this knowledge on before it is too late, you know.
Now, you yourself are a repository of all this massive amount of stories and information, probably more than anybody in this area, would you say?
Yeah, a lot of people recognise me, that a lot of knowledge behind me. I've been doing it pretty much all my childhood, and my grandfather was a big role model of mine. He was a very cultural, spiritual man, and hunter and gatherer. I'm more a hunter, not a gatherer. My grandma's a gatherer. And
what was his name?
Claudie Douglas, and he's actually deceased now, but he actually died in my arms, and I'm quite lucky that in grandkids he had. He actually passed all these stories on to me, and he actually passed on my arms to tell me the last couple of stories that actually happened within this area, especially up in the Wimmera, so up in northwest of the Wimmera Valley. Is where my grandma was originally from. It was known as the Wachibulik clan. But my grandfather was one of the last that's been recorded to be known. He was the last of the Jalpajali that lived in the northwest of Gariwerd, where now it's known as the Grampians. And he invited my grandma, she was a Wachibulik lady. So I was very lucky to have him as a very strong role model. He taught me all this knowledge that I've known today. So I'm very very respected in this community for the non-Indigenous people, and also the Indigenous in my community itself. I've been doing it from the age of 12, 13, I'm turned 30, started next year, and just at Brambuk Cultural Heritage Centre, I started working at the age of 12, I'm probably 13, 14 year old, and I've been here since. I went to the city for a while, but I couldn't stand it, it's just too fast for me, and this is my home. You can probably see in these vintage, and a lot of footage that Jeff has actually provided for you, it's a beautiful country. So if you had a chance to come over here, I do say to come and visit us.
I think this is one of the most, I've traveled all around Australia for 12 years, and this is one of the most special and powerful and beautiful places in all of Australia, both Halls Gap and Gariwerd National Park, and I've seen very little of it, but I'd love to see a lot more. A lot of it's quite remote and some of these special rock art sites. And tell me, what would you say are some of the most sort of like sacred and powerful places here, but discounting the rock art sites? Like you mentioned a place called Pink Lake to me the other day. You said it was Tingle's Heart, Tingle being the...
Tringle was known as a giant
Emmy. Tringle.
Yeah, Tringle. There's a number of Dreamtime stories actually that did survive this area from white settlement. A lot of them has been lost. When first white settlement come throughout this area, a lot of people don't realise, down the southern part of Australia, we copped it pretty bad. There was over 75-80% were murdered and massacred, mainly women and young children.
Did much of that happen right in this area where we are?
Just in Gariwerd itself, especially the Japurung people, they copped it pretty bad. And I lived in the southeast of Gariwerd, and they're very nice what they did to that clan or that tribe. And So like I was saying, it was over 75-80% women and children have been murdered and massacred. It was very disgusting. And a lot of my ancestors were the warriors, you know, they were shackled up from their necks to their wrists to the ankles and taken out properties and used as slaves. And a lot of that was hidden, you know, it was never documented. The European, like, or the British didn't want to document none of that. They only documented all the good stuff, what they think they'd done. But
And wrote the history books accordingly.
Yeah, and that's white history, and that's why I tell a lot of kids and a lot of international that come here and visit the Brambuk Cultural Centre that you got to realise that Australian history, you know, the white history about Captain James Cook, you know, the British and that, that's not Australian history. The history here is black history, and it's always going to be black history. If my ancestors survived, you know, the 40, 50,000 years, you know, we've got a big future still ahead of us. And that's why I tell a lot of people that come through the doors of Brambuk Cultural Centre, it's about that respect and understanding. And there's a lack of respect and understanding.
There is.
Still today, and that's hard, you know, to work in a white society, you know. And
a big part of what I hope that I've always been trying to do, and like with this video right here, is create awareness in people's mind of how ignorant they are and how their simple lack of awareness and knowledge is very disrespectful to the real people whose land this really is.
That's right, Jeff. Not many people know, you know, what happened, though. Like I was saying, the massacres took place, and later on, the missionaries started opening in the 18th century, And a lot of people don't know, and they're still ignorant and don't want to hear it today, but it's good that Brambuk, with a lot of panels upstairs that sort of explain that history of what took place before, when the white settlement did come here. And the missionaries, a lot of nasty things did happen. The first mission was built here in Victoria, it was called Ebenezer. A lot of my ancestors were taken to, the Jalpajali and also the Wachibali clan. And not many people know, but a lot of rapes did take place in that missionary. The non-Indigenous man actually raped an Indigenous lady, and then she would fall pregnant. Then once she gave him birth to that child, she actually was murdered on the spot. And that child was actually taken into white society and become, or raised, as a European.
They murdered the mom?
Yeah.
So Why did they do that?
Just to break our race down,
oh,
pretty
my,
much.
And dude, this is fucking so horrific. Just all this. I keep learning more and more.
And a lot of people don't understand and know that history, you know, and it's just ignorant and that stereotype, you know, and still today, like I tell a lot of people, you know, we're in the 2000th century, and still today, it all starts education at school, you know, and a lot of us Indigenous kids get pushed to the back of the classroom, you know, because it's just that stereotype, we're dumb, you know, we're black and we're feral, you know, it's just a load of crap, you know. They got to realise they were the first race in the whole world itself, you know, and it's just that ignorant, no respect, understanding, you know, so when I was going to school, it was always talk about Captain James Cook, the British and all that stuff, you know. I'd go home confused and ask Mum, you know, what's going on, and just that racism in the school ground. I call them Bung, Abba, and all this stuff, and Coon, and go back to your own country, and I was confused and lost and very depressed and always angry, and there's always a lot of fights in the school grounds, and got me suspended, expelled, and that.
Tell us about what happened at Christmas of last year.
It was a big incident. I done a bit of a stretch in prison there. It's just ignorant again. People come down here and they want to put this pipeline through. And my grandfather, you know, he taught me, and a lot of uncles taught me. You know, like I was talking about earlier on. Mother, she owns us, you know, we don't own her. And just rude, ignorant, you know. And these white fellas got no idea, you know, just respect of our country. And what they've done, what my part of my job was to do was actually site mine most of the grounds they're going to dig. And there was a number of sacred sites that we come across. And there was one incident at the pub, we call it Waterhole here in Australia, but at the pub here, and all the non-Indigenous man was drinking at one end of the bar, and us Indigenous Bob was sitting in the other end of the bar, and I just happened to come through the crowd of the non-Indigenous and heard these two young boys having a conversation saying, we don't give a shit what we dig up. And
because they were going to put the pipeline through a burial ground.
Through a burial ground, and so I jumped up and said a few words, and a lot of my uncles said, no, don't ruin me. I never back down. Always, what Pop said, always fight. What do you think is, you know, it's right? And I fought, and it made me very depressed. And ended up flogging eight blokes and ended up doing 6 months in jail. You know, and it was over shit, you know, just lack of understanding, you know. And
but because of that, they diverted the pipeline so as not to violate the burial ground. Is that true?
Yeah, that was the big argument. But they wanted to dig through the actual burial ground itself, but. And part of the agreement was they got to dig 200 metres away from that site itself, the burial ground. So they did come to an agreement later on, and we come back to the centre into the war room here, and we sat around the table and tried to discuss this over the table before I actually done that 6 months in prison. And but when I got out, again, a lot of respect in that, but the sad thing was when I got out of prison, I was barred from my own country, my own country. my own people and that. It was hard, and I was barred from here for 3 years, Halls Gap itself. We call it Budja Budja, was the traditional name for this area. But now it's known as Halls Gap, the European term for it. I was also barred from the two country towns, and only 25k is the closest, is Store, and another town, about 100k, is my own birthplace, is Horsham. And we call it Old Back Gundala, was our traditional name. So I was barred for 3 years from my country, and my culture, and my me, you know, myself. So Dick made me very angry, and still am confused and lost. And why is a white man so ignorant, you know? And
as I was telling you before, I feel ashamed to be in the body of a white man sometimes, but I'm not really white. It's just a disguise that lets me walk in this world and do more damage. But I'm actually of an Native American and Black Australian and part whale and dolphin inside too, and part eucalyptus tree.
It's just the name, people like yourself, Jeff, you know. There's a lot of inner people out there, and that's what I was saying, like, the education side of it, you know, like, and that stereotype, why Aboriginal people, Indigenous people, or Koori people, are in parks drinking, you know, and we got to think of it, it all starts from education, you know. It's that lack of education from day one, going to school, you know. And then once you leave school, there's no employment for us, you know. Non-Indigenous person going to employ an Indigenous man or a woman, because that stereotype back in the household, you know, all Aboriginal people bad, you know, it was scum and that. Just...
We've met a lot of white Australians that think that way, and always try to explain that, go like, but dude, look at what's happened.
That's right.
The white people came from Europe here a couple hundred years ago and basically genocided. They just murdered them all and stole their land, and then now these people aren't able to go back and live where they belong, but they don't fit into this society in a lot of ways, because it's not their, I mean, that they're sort of, it's complex, but a lot of people are sort of caught in this limbo in between, just like you said. And it's like, I think that with enough creating awareness and also working on ways to creatively inspire people to want to know more about how the beauty and power and spiritual evolution level of the Indigenous people of Australia, which I'm very aware of, I think the coolest people on the whole planet. Light years ahead of what we call civilization, because you guys have lived here for tens of thousands of years in harmony with the earth. Look at what civilization has done. Just in the past 100 years, we're literally destroying the earth, and we've got our most advanced technologies as weapon systems aimed at each other. So to live in your ancient way is really the goal that we should all strive for.
That's right, yeah. And that's what we're trying to do as well in the alchemy, you know, start, you know, growing our own, you know, veggies and your fruits and that, but all native, you know, none of this European stuff, you know. We want to try to get that Indigenous garden happen and start teaching our young ones, you know, to grow it and look after it and then eat off it and rotate that circle of life. And that's what, you know, Mother Earth is part of us, you know. We've got to look after her, you know, you've got to respect her. If not, she's going to give up on us. And that's where the confusion white settlement, you know, there's a lot of greed, power, you know, and money, you know. Money is the worst thing ever. I can't stand the money. We call it bunda here in the Aboriginal term or Koori term. And it is the worst thing. It's a demon, you know.
It's a false god that people worship. They'll do anything for it.
And that's what I can't understand. And the white man, their power and greed and that. And it's just that lack of understanding, you know, that she owns us, we don't own her. And she is giving up on us, you know, and same that pipeline they put for her. And that's what granddad said, you know, as when I was a young boy, like, you look at it from what we call known as a reptile, or known as bundle, is the wedge-tailed eagle, that, you know, looking from his point of view, looking from bird's eye view, looking down at Mother Earth itself, or the country, and all the waterways, you know. If there's no waterways in these creeks or rivers or anything, she's going to give up on us. And that's what granddad told me, like, that's Mother Earth's veins, you know. If them veins are not flowing, that's it, you know, and they're going to put these pipelines around to supply water to other townships. Well, stop bringing these people over. You want to get water? You got these creeks now that go collect water. My ancestors would have done. You got rock wells in that we would have went bathed and gathered our water from for drinking purposes and whatnot, or cooking. And white men, I don't know, they just confuse me, and I don't understand some of them. And
what about digging out gold?
That's another one, gold. And see, gold was useless to us Koori's here in Victoria itself, because couldn't make no tools or any artifacts out of it.
I don't understand why the white man is so obsessed with it.
Well, it's got me bugging too, Jeff. So you're saying in Ballarat, you know, the gold rush took place down there, and it was just full on. You know, a lot of the Wathaurong people around the Ballarat district were murdered and massacred for the gold rush, you know. And there's a lot of stupid stories that I read in books that the, you know, back in the 18th century, I used to work at the gold museum many years ago down in Ballarat, and some of the stuff in the back office is just what a load of crap, you know. And they reckon that the indigenous person actually would murder the Chinese and were Hannibals, we ate them and took their gold off them. Why would we do that? Gold was useless to us, you know. We didn't go into the country town and, you know, get a bag of flour or tea or whatever, or sugar or whatever. So all that stupid stories they had, and they hid it, you know, and it's still sitting in the back of the museums, and it should be out there promoted and let people know, you know, what it's just stupid stuff they said and what they make us look like we're bad people. And I don't understand it, realise it.
Have you heard of this concept called, I may not pronounce it right, I think it's terra nullius, or terra nullius. It's that the doctrine, when the British first came, they declared Australia terra nullius. It means the land of nothing, or an empty land with no people, because all they saw was what they thought was the primitive savage subhuman people here, and then and declared it as British territory because there was nobody here, and that's like that should, I mean, the Crown of England should be charged with criminal trespassing now.
That's correct.
And made to pay amends to all the people and damages for all the millions of people that have been slaughtered here. It's unbelievable.
Same as my partner's grandfather, you know, Pop Jack, and he went to the Second World War and he fought over there, you know, and he came back home and got no recognition, you know. He came back home and he was promised land, you know, country, and he got nothing, you know. None of us got nothing. We come back home and now I just seen an article a few months ago that they're trying to say there wasn't not one Indigenous person from Australia went over and fought that war. What a lot of shit that was. And when we come back, and if some of the RSLs here in Australia, we're going to go in and get a can of milk because we're all black, you know. And I remember going with my grandfather and, a little bit to do with the war, and there's a lot of shit, you know. I wanted to go, you know, come pop going here for a can of milk, you know, and a few beers or whatnot, and just, I can't go on the grandson. Oh boy, because he was black, you know, he had a black skin. What a lot of shit this is, you know. You just help fought for our country, and they do this to us, you know. So that's why I'm sort of getting angry and frustrated. I'm trying to fight, you know, and let people know, you know, out there, it is still hard to frustrate, like even today, you know. They're trying to white settlement, and I feel bad. I'm very frustrated with my ancestors, what they've done to my ancestors.
Yes.
You know, my grandfather and that, and there's no respect, you know.
Well, you know what? I'd like to offer my services to you right now to help in any way I can to work on this goal that I share with you. And I think, how cool would it be if we actually made a movie about this sometime and brought in like footage from the different rock art sites and showing some of the bush tucker and people doing different things and have you tell some stories and talk with different people and stuff. Something like that could be really, really cool.
I've been doing it all the same, age 12, I don't grow up with it. It's always been part of my background, and through my granddaddy, always tagged around and I was his shadow. And we always taught, you know. It's never written down, never documented. There's always word of mouth, you know, and it still is today, you know. We are the oldest race that's been recorded in the world, and some of the rapes that took place in the missionary, you know, that's why you won't come across a full-blooded Indigenous person down here no more, a real half-caste like myself, you know. The reason for that is the missionary days. A lot of rapes did take place, and they broke the skin tone down to become Europeans ourselves. And all the full-blooded Kuri men and women were actually left on missionaries until they quietly died. And just where Ebenezer, where a lot of my ancestors were taken to, there's over 150 unmarked graves. And it's just disgusting, you know. Like, and lucky, you know, I've got a lot of uncles and a lot of other cousins are actually working together now. And it's called a land council called Brinji Gajan, which is based in Fibro Street in Horsham. And they're actually getting all the family back together now and starting to fight against the white man, you know, and starting to get our land back, you know, get our Ebenezer back, you know, get our mission back, and Antwerp, and very sacred sites out there, and start informing our children, not just our children, but the non-Indigenous kids, you know, and break that barrier of racism. People got to realise, you know, we are the first race, and we are the oldest race, and it's just a respect understanding for us people, and let people realise, you know, why are we so light-skinned today? Because it's going back to the missionaries. Then after that, the stolen generation, you know. My mum was stolen, you know.
Now tell us about that.
Yeah, my mum was stolen, a stolen generation, and she grew up in a white society as an infant, as a young baby, and she didn't have actually met a real father, my grandfather, my grandmother, until she was 16. Then later on, she then met her brother and brother and sisters till she was 17, 18, you know, and they actually going to the same school together, not knowing they were brother and sisters. So very hard and frustrating. And still today, my mother's very confused, you know, and she's lost. And
now here we are with the flag. Now tell us about this.
We weren't allowed to have our indigenous flag up to 1972, and it was. So we actually fought. But actually what it means is the black on top there represents the colour of the people, or the ancestors, in the past and present. Also the yellow in the middle of the circle represents the sun. We call it Ningyuk down this way. And also the red, which means the blood was spilt for white settlement, and also Mother Earth herself, the red soil. So this is the original Australian flag. That's why I can't really stand or understand the Australian flag. We've got the British sort of emblem in the top left-hand side, and also got the Southern Cross. And that's what even Uncle Jeff here, Uncle Jeff Clark, is actually starting to fight against the government again, and the politics and whatnot. I don't know why they actually got that Southern Cross on their flag, because that's part of our Dreamtime story, our creation story.
That represents Tringle, doesn't it?
Yeah, it represents Bundle himself, Wild Crow, Tringle, the Giant Emu, the Baron Brown Book Brothers were two legends to roam this era. And what their job is carry the customs, the laws, the languages, get into the creatures or the animals, and teach all of us how to survive Mother Earth. So that's what Brambuk's actually originally named after. It was named after the two Brambuk Book Brothers, the two legends that roamed this area to pass all them customs and laws and whatnot on. So, and that's what part of that Southern Cross is. There's a lot of stories throughout the whole Australia. The ancestors would have passed on to our young ones. And most of our stories were told mainly through the stars. The ancestors, the elders will sit there amongst us young children and sit there and tell yarns and stories throughout the stars. It wasn't done through the stars, it was usually done through song and dance, or Benham's corroboree today. It wasn't done through corroboree, it was usually done through rock art. So getting back to the rock art, like we were saying before, there's over 300 rock art sites been recorded within the park itself. Now, there's only five of them open to the public.
Have you visited a lot of those?
Yeah, I've been to a lot of them that aren't open to the public. When my grandfather was alive, and also a lot of other uncles, Uncle Archie, which is deceased as well. Uncle Nyuk, again deceased. There's a lot of them, Uncle or Pop Jack and that. There's a lot of people that passed on. Also my partner Carla, her father, John, was another big role model of mine. He taught me a lot.
Were they able to tell you specific like dreaming stories associated with these different rock art sites and things like that?
Yeah, there's a lot, especially my ancestors on my grandfather's side, the Jalpajali in the northwest, and very strong country over that side, and very powerful and spiritual. And a lot of rude kids, like I was saying earlier on, there's over 400 rock art sites, but there's only five open to the public. Now, the reason for that, over the years, been open for tourism in the public itself. A lot of rude teenage kids were teenage, just human race itself, ignorant and lack of respect. They've actually out there and vandalised a lot of our rock art, graffiti, even taking chips of this ochre. Mm-hmm. And put them in money bags and try and sell them on eBay. So it's coming from a famous rock art site.
Oh my
God. It's just disgusting. They have no respect at all. So back in 1989 and 99, in 90 itself, sorry, we had to put these cages around these rock art, and it's very disgusting. I remember as a young child coming out to these rock art sites, and there was no such thing as these cages around there. And a lot of uncles, also my grandfather, would sit there and teach us young ones, you know, that what these stories were about. And it's just that oral history passed on from story, from word of mouth, that oral history. And it's sad that a lot of these stories have actually been lost, you know. And there's a number of stories that I sort of keep in myself, you know. And I might share to no one. I only share my borrowers, my children, and I don't actually see my kids. Their mothers know that, because I was a pretty, a rebel. When I was a young teenager, I got a lot of strife. It's just because that's confusing, you know, growing up, being an Indigenous person here. And not getting the chance, opportunity, and I was very angry, and always using my fists, you know. And my grandmother always said, "You use your tongue, you know. Your tongue's worse than a whip, you know." And it's a little scar for life. But today, because of the white society, the white law, you can't use your tongue no more. It'll get you locked up, you know. So it is very hard being a Koori man or a Koori person here in Victoria. But lately, the last probably 6-7 years, I'm starting to realise and understand. As you're saying, there's a lot of changes starting to happen. That a non-Indigenous person is actually starting to respect us and understand us, and it's taken like 230 years actually for this respect to understand. So it's good for our young ones. They're starting to get jobs and their opportunity to what it was when I was back at school, you know, back in so the late 80s, early 90s, and it was that lack of understanding. And now it's part of my role being an education culture officer here at Brambuk Cultural Centre. And I actually work a lot of job network agencies around Wimmera and also Gariwerd, all the Grampians area, to actually employ Indigenous kids. Give us a chance, you know, give us an opportunity, you know. So that, it is starting to change, you know, that they are starting to respect this, understand a little bit more, but still it's a lot of them old ones that we've got to hit and target, you know, and then, so they can actually hit their children, you know. And I do a lot of talks in a lot of retirement homes, you know, and a lot of people, they don't know that history, you know, what happened to us, what their ancestors have done to us. So it's always been hidden. So when I go do my talks in these nursing homes or whatnot, a lot of them are quite shame and feel guilt what they've done. It wasn't them, it was their ancestors, you know.
But we, it's a burden that we all carry. All of us. I'm always saying that we're, in a way, everybody that's alive now, all the white people, we're responsible for what these ancestors of ours have done. Yeah. And it's, I think it's impossible for the white man to think he can live in harmony right on top of all this genocide that's still going on.
It's still going on.
Same in America. It's like, I don't think it's, there's too many deep spiritual wounds that could maybe be healed eventually if people really focused on it, but instead they're just like in denial of it.
Yeah. Just everyone's right about themselves, and you know, like, we're growing up, it's always the family, you know, and everyone's equal. Where today, the white society, it's always above, and you know, there's never no above, no below, you know, in our community, and everyone was treated equal, you know, no one was higher than anyone, no one was below than anyone. So, and in a white society, you know, that's that greed and power, it goes back to that, and money, you know, and it's just stupid, and I can't understand it. And it's not just here in Australia, it's back over there in the States, you know.
It's global.
It's everywhere, you know, Canada, everywhere, and especially New Zealand, it's the same thing over there, you know, and it's just that lack of knowledge and understanding, you know, the traditional owners of the countries, and respecting their beliefs, you know. And especially here in Gariwerd, a lot of the Djapadjali and also the Djaparong, I was taken to a place in Ararat called Jayward, and what they originally built that insane prison was is built for mentally insane people. And the reason why they built that prison, or what's called known as Jayward, is for us Indigenous people within this area. They thought we were stupid because our beliefs, our customs and the laws, and the belief in the Bunjil and the dialects that we spoke within this area, there's over probably 30 to 40 different dialects within Victoria itself, none of us spoke the same lingo. So they thought we were stupid. Thought we were crazy, and they built these built like prisons and put us in there. We thought we call them Bunta or Jubi, yeah, but thought we were just crazy, you know, stupid. And then later on, they started putting their own kind in, you know, the British and also the Irish and all that. And it was just stupid what they done to us. And then later on, like back in the, I put them in the 60s, you know, 50s and 60s, a lot of death in custody. And still today, a lot of death in custody, you know. And when I'd done that 6 months in prison now in Melbourne, I was disgusted how many uncles and cousins were in there, you know. There's over 80% Indigenous people all locked up in there, all Indigenous men. And I sat in the yard there and I spoke to a lot of my uncles and cousins. Like, fuck, where you been, you know? Like, I haven't seen you for years, thought you might have been deceased. And they've been in there and they're too scared and they can't reconnect with country out there on the outside. And that's why I sat there and talked to them the 6 months in there. I said, come on, uncle, come on, cuz, you got to get out there and reconnect with country, you know. Go back, find your roots, find your custom and laws, you know, and what tribe, what clan you come from. And probably out of the 60 was in there, there's probably about 40 that haven't re-offended, you know. The other 20 probably gone in there and re-offend. But that's when a lot of uncles told me, we needed someone like yourself, Roony, to come in here and somewhat young and very passionate about our culture and tell us that, you know. And because going back to that stereotype, lack of, you know, education and going employment, no employment, and what we do, you know, is that stereotype, we go in the bottle shop, we go in the park, we wipe ourselves out. And it is true, but the reason for it, we are hurt and suffering. We don't know how to live in the white man society because there's no opportunities for us. There's no gateways, there's no goals for us because we've been wiped out and been and just pushed aside, you know, left behind. And that's why I get frustrated. I go down to Melbourne and I see a lot of uncles and that sitting in the park, and I go and have a yarn and I'm like, come on, don't wake up yourself. I know, what is your problem? No, what is it? And a lot of them are saying, look, Roony, mate, we don't know, we're lost and confused. And I know that myself. And I was there going that way, you know. And I was lucky that I had a home to come to, like a beautiful country like I've got here at Gariwerd. And I'm very lucky to have this. And,
absolutely.
And it was lucky I had a home to come back to. A lot of the other uncles and cousins that, they haven't got a place to come to like this. So I do cherish it, you know, and I'm very passionate from my ancestors that roamed this area. And that's what a lot of the uncles actually, when they had been released, they've gone back, reconnect with country, you know, and found out they reconnect with country, Mother Earth, you know, and culture. And a lot of them have gotten back, you know, into their culture, and, you know, it could be paint, you know, making artifacts or whatnot, and keep away from that, I suppose, that pack of people that's leading in the wrong way, in the wrong direction.
Mm-hmm.
And they actually reconnect with country and they become strong themselves, become warriors. And Bundles respect them again, Mother Earth respected them, and haven't really offended. And the other thing is, mainly is, especially in the city there, is the powders, the drugs. And a lot of us in our community do smoke a lot of yandi, or known as marijuana, we call it yandi here. And that's probably the best thing for us, you know. And it would have been old medicines back in that, you know, back before this was introduced to us. But a lot of our young ones are going that wrong way, and they're starting the powders, you know. And now here in Australia, the biggest killer is the ice, you know, and that's fucking unbelievable. And I can't talk. I went to Melbourne, you know? I was a young teenager, and I was on heroin, you know, and I started at the age of 9.5. My first offence was 9.5, and I'm still barred from Smith Street in Collingwood Fitzroy. And the reason for that was I was a little trafficker. I was a little runner for the main dealers down there, Vietnamese boys, and I got caught at the age of 9.5 years old with a 9mm Beretta and 2 machetes in the front of me and 2.5 grams of heroin in my mouth in balloons and in water balloons. And it was stupid, and it's still barred for today, you know, from Smith Street. And I can't stand Melbourne. It fucked me up, it ruined me. And later on, my mum, you know, she started hitting the heroin pretty bad, and she started turning into a junkie. And she, you know, hot cold sweats, joint aches all the time, just screaming her guts out in the bed. And so I had to go out and do quick earns, rorts and that, and to go get smack for her, you know, and to keep her happy, you know. And then that was her medicine pretty much, to keep her going. That first offence, you know, it confused me a lot, and especially getting bashing the cells and that. And they could have killed me, they could have got rid of me. But I had a few cousins that worked in the legal aid and that down here in Australia, as Aboriginal legal aid, and they've come in and they actually bailed me out, they got me out, and they took me back home at the country of Horsham, and it's a little country town. And I started reconnecting my culture, my family, my country, and growing up, you know, being a Koori person, you know, and I started connecting, you know, going to see granddad every day, and going out with my uncles, and, you know, take me to these sites or whatever, and teach me these stuff. I was very lucky to actually, from there, come back to where I'm home now, and we all fuck up, you know, we all go the wrong way. But at the end of the day, it's up to us, you know, and we're only here once, and that's why I tell a lot of young Indigenous kids, you know, I'm a bit of a role model in my community, that we only got one choice, boys, you know, and that's it. If you're mum and family, you only got one opportunity, and at the end of the day, it's up to you. You can't, it's not mum and dad's going to do it for you, or granddad or whatever, or grandma. At the end of the day, it's up to you. You're number one, and you got a goal, you got a dream, you chase that dream and goal, you know. Probably 99% you're gonna see that goal, you know. And the biggest thing now is education, and I know it's probably the last 5 or 6 years that there is a lot of education is being pushed out to us Indigenous kids, and we are getting recognised and understand now. We are sitting in the front rows, not being pushed about the classroom. It was back in 2003, that there's myself and Aaron Clark, another cousin of mine, and Colin Cow, a gentleman from Darwin, a non-Indigenous man. We actually started the curriculum. They changed the curriculum and stopped talking about British and Captain James Cook or whatnot, and start talking about Indigenous people, what happened to us before white settlement, how we survived this era, and then talk about the white settlement, what happened to us from the massacres, you know, and to the poison water holes, and to the missionaries, to the stolen generations and whatnot. So that knowledge is it's been passed on, and it starts from preschool up to kindergartens, right up, you know, to private public schools, to Catholic schools, into secondary colleges, and up to universities. So it took us a lot of years. I think I started when I was about 16, and I didn't get it till I was 21. So it was a very big birthday present, my 21st birthday, and to actually achieve that and got that out there. And it's gone everywhere throughout Australia. They've got to talk about Indigenous culture first before the British and Captain James Cook and whatnot, what I was taught back in school. And so a lot of non-Indigenous kids are actually starting to realise and understand this. And it's about, I don't know what colour we are, it's just, we're all human. You know, we're all running race at the end of it. And it's just that understanding and respect now in school grounds, which has become stronger now. Because Australia now is a very multicultural culture,
mm-hmm.
a country, sorry. And And it's about the respect and understand each other, that we are all human, no matter what race or what colour we are. At the end of the day, we are all human. And it's about working together now and become one, pretty much. And if we don't do that, she's going to give up on us, Mother Earth. And just here in Gariwerd, you know, back in 2006, we had very serious bushfires that took place in the park here. There's over 47,000 hectares, it was all on flames, you know. And from there, just over 12 months ago, we had over 100 mil rain. And it caused a lot of landslides in the park itself. There's over 297 landslides that took place in the park itself. So it's been one extreme to another, and that's why I tell the people, it's just Mother Earth letting us know she's still in charge. Don't mess with her, you know. If we do, we're going to cop it. So, and she's actually telling us. So hopefully the young ones are actually going to be watching this. I hope you do take it all in and understand it, respect it, you know, and just remember that we are all equal. We're all one, you know, and it's just about working together. If we don't do it, she's going to give up on us, you know.
Yes, Mother Earth. I was gave Roony a copy of Koyana Skatsi, the film by Ron Fricke, and was explaining about how the Hopi prophecy talks about how that the earth has been destroyed by the Great Spirit three or four times before because the people got so far off the true path. And this word, Koyana Skatsi, it means life out of balance, and that actually describes the nature of what our civilization is and what it's doing to Mother Earth right now. And I really think that that's what's so interesting, because the many different ancient cultures sort of talk about similar type things.
Yeah, like,
great planetary catastrophes and stuff like that. And I think that what we try to tell people that our basic message that we're getting from Mother Earth and the whales and dolphins, for us it's not anything. It's a very practical message. It's telling us that we should live simply so that others may simply live, because most the whole modern Wasichu mentality is so greed and money oriented, and people want to have all this stuff, stupid cars and houses and technology and buildings and all this stuff, and it's actually destroying us and the earth. And if we got rid of most of that stuff that we don't need, we would be much healthier.
That's right, yeah. That's good.
But so you were going to share a story with us.
Yeah, just an old dream story my grandfather passed on to us, younger boys, and my cousin, my younger brother, and whatnot. He called it Mawumba. Now, Mawumba meant honey to us indigenous people, our Kuris here in Victoria. In the dream time story that he taught us, there was two twin boys that are born in his tribe and clan. And it wasn't very often there was two twin kids born on tribes and clans. So these two twin boys were very special to everyone, of course, and very cheeky young characters. Now, from a certain age, around about 5-6 year old, they'd take off out in the scrub, out in the bush, without telling the parents or telling the rest of the clan or tribe where they were going, or telling the elders where they were going. And they'd been out in the bush for a number of hours, going what they called known as Mawumba hunting. So what they tend to do, the two young boys would actually go out in the scrub, look up in the trees, looking for honeycombs up in the trees. Once they actually approached them, they got pretty excited, as young children do. So what I tend to do from there is actually picked up rocks and sticks from the ground and started throwing at this beehive up in the tree, or honeycomb tree. And so the two young boys actually got this beehive down, and of course come down, hit the ground, busted open, all this honey started pouring out of it. So they both ran overexcited and they started feeding their faces, throwing honey at each other, and good laugh, a good time. And they've been doing it since our young boys, and without a doubt, every time they come home back to camp, Mum was never happy with them, because without a doubt they come home all honey over them, always sticky. So Mum had to take me into a wetlands and give them bogey, which is known as bathing or bath today. But like I was saying, they've been doing it since they were young children. They're growing up now, teenage years, around about 16, 17-year-olds. There was one tall, skinny one. He was a little bit more switched on, a little bit more wise than the other brother. The other brother, a little short, chubby fella, and all he was right about was his belly. And his favourite food, of course, was Mawumba. And it was one day to sit around the campfire and have a bit of tucker, and a bit of lunch, you know, a bit of tucker around the campfire with all the elders and all the clan and tribe. And the little short chub one just had to be sitting next to his other brother, and he started nudging him. He goes, "Come on, brother, I don't like eating this food. You know my favourite food, Mawumba. Let's go bush look for Mawumba for me." So he kept nagging him, and the taller skinny one, he gave in, he had enough. So he jumped on his feet and he goes, "Come on then, brother, we'll take you out bush. We'll look for Mawumba for you." So they've been out there for a number of hours with a little short chubby one, is good probably 30 to 40 metres away. He started yelling and screaming, "Mawumba, Mawumba, Mawumba over here." So the taller skinny one ran out of excitement. Think they come across Mawumba. He stood back, looked up at this tree, and it's a little bit different shape to the ones been knocking down since they were young children. So he started trying to advise the short, chubby brother. He started telling him, "Hey, brother, I don't think it's a good idea to knock that beehive down. I'm telling you, it's not a good idea. It's a little bit different shape than what's been knocking down since we're young children." But the little short, chubby one started carrying on. He started chucking a tantrum, swearing, cursing at the other brother. He started yelling, "I don't care what you say. That's my favourite food up there, my womb, but that's my favourite food. I don't care what you say." So it was the first young boy, of course, picked up this big rock, or young teenage boy, picked this big rock up, and he pipped at this beehive. By then, he's found about a dozen. Well, the tall, skinny one still standing back and still trying to advise him. "It's not a good idea, brother. I'm telling you, it's not a good idea. A little bit different shape than one we've been knocking down since we were young boys." But then he started thinking to himself, he don't start helping out, putting his share in to get this beehive down. If his beehive comes down, hits the ground, busts it open, all his honey starts pouring out, he's not going to share him. He's going to be greedy. So he decided too, I better start helping out, started throwing rocks and sticks at this beehive. Eventually, these two young teenage boys, they got this beehive down. Again, hit the ground, bust it open. All his honey started pouring out of it. So they both ran excitement as our young boys again. Started feeding the faces, throwing hand at each other, and a good time, a good laugh. Till next minute, this big swarm of bees come along. Stung them. They got a bit confused, a bit worried, a bit frightened. I couldn't work out why these bees were stinging them. So they ran all the way back to camp, crying. They approached camp. They told the rest of the elders that there's bees that can sting you. All the elders, they started cracking up laughing. They thought these young boys had lost the plot, and they were going a bit stupid, crazy. And they're telling the young boys, "You two young boys must have gone a bit stupid, you know, because when we're young children, we go out there look for Mawumba. No such thing, the bee can sting us. You two young boys going a bit crazy, I think, you know, losing the plot." So the two young teenage boys got a bit offended. They started yelling and screaming back at the elders. They said, "Come on, you big shots, you don't believe us. We'll take you out there. We'll show you the bee that can sting you." So the two young boys, they storm off with anger, with the tribe and clan sort of hanging back and a good chuckle fit these young boys had lost the plot. So they actually approached this beehive. There's still honey still pouring out of it. So everyone thought, "We're not going to let this honey go to waste." So everyone started feeding their faces, throwing honey in each other, all acting like young children again, having a good time, a good laugh. Then next bit, this big swarm of bees come back, stung everyone. So everyone got a bit confused, a bit worried, thinking, "How come these bees sting us?" And they, "Well, we're young children, no such thing, the bee can sting us. What's going on today, Mother Earth?" So they slowly made their way back to camp. They sort of got halfway to the campsite was to where this beehive was lying. And these two young teenage boys end up collapsing. They end up dying. They're allergic to this bee sting. But they were the first two boys who discovered the European bee. Here in Australia, there's no such thing as European bee. It was actually introduced to Australia. The only bee that we had here in Australia is known as a black bee, or even as a native bee. Never had no sting.
They're little small ones, aren't they?
Yeah, little small followers. And after all them years going, my ancestors are going to collect my womba, it's always been a native bee or a black bee. To this one type of year, when white settlement come here, these young boys just discovered the European bee. So now, out of respect, you might notice we call them Yadakis, but originally come from NT of Australia and also some parts of Queensland and also Western Australia, known as a didgeridoo today. We call them Yadaki. Now, Yadakis actually traded down to us, but down here in the southern part of Australia, but we're in the mouthpiece of the Yadaki or didgeridoo. You might notice the beeswax. Now, the main purpose for that beeswax is to respect them to young boys who actually discovered the European bee. And also so we can protect it, protect our lips, sorry, from itchiness, from the timber, and also so we can shape it so it can actually fit in the hierarchy. But the main purpose for that beeswax being on top of that mouthpiece is to respect them to young boys, actually discovered the European bee. So now you know the reason why we've got the beeswax on top of the didgeridoo, or Benazza, we call it hierarchy, is the artificial name for it. But yeah, to respect them to young boys. And that's the Mawumba story, that one of the stories my grandfather passed on to us. Now, there is a number of stories that did survive this area. Some of them from my grandfather, also my partner's grandfather, and also a lot of uncles. And from European settlement, like I was saying, they thought we were crazy and stupid because our beliefs and customs and laws and our storytelling, you know. And a lot of it was hidden, especially at missionaries. My grandfather's father, my great-grandfather lived on the missionary, and he actually he took off on a mission as a young fellow, and he actually practiced his culture, used to go hunt his own food, and go instead of going out eating the white man's food and that. And all the story my grandfather told me, I know that no matter what they try to do to us, our culture is always going to be with us, you know, in here, you know. But it's got to always come from here first, and you got to listen, you know, to the elders, you know. Never disrespect your elders, you know. And that's probably the big thing in our community is respect, you know. And if we don't have respect to our people, why be here, you know? And that's why it's so big in our community, you know, and why we've lived for thousands of years, because that respect, you know, honesty, always have respect for the elders, you know. If you didn't show respect, you never got taught nothing. So if you, like myself, I had respect for a lot of my uncles, and you know, a lot of my aunties, and that's why a lot of these stories have been told to me, passed on to me. And it's very important for myself to keep these stories word for word, because it is an oral history, it is a custom of law. And that's why the white man can't understand, you know, why we don't document none of these. We don't want to document none of these. We want to keep that law and custom here. To keep oral history, keep it in our own soul. And then we can pass on to next borrow, next generation. Then hopefully they pass on to my grandkids, man, my own other boroughs from there. And if it's lasting over 40,000 years, why couldn't it last another 40, 50,000 years, you know? So it's about respect and understand now and keep it respect, you know, and that we're all equal and we're only here once, and it's about time that we do work together and start realising what we're doing to Mother Earth, you know, before it is too late. And I'm telling her, it's not far now, but she is going to give up on us, you know, and it's going to happen. And Granddad always mentioned that she's had enough, you know, and as he's been deceased nearly for 10, 11 years now, and I'm starting to think that he is right, you know, and the climate is so ruined from this pollution we put in her and in the air, and especially in jets, you know, and then planes going over.
The chemtrails.
The chemtrails are leaving behind, and a lot of people don't know about that.
And HARP.
Yeah, HARP, and my partner, Carla, she knows a lot about that, and she makes her laugh and joke about it, but I know she knows what she's on about. And,
no, so many people, yeah. they think it's like science fiction that couldn't really be real, but dude, it is real.
It is real, yeah. I know myself, but I told you because it's just the way we are. Us black fellas here sort of laugh amongst each other, I know. And she sort of gets a bit serious and angry, but I know that it's true with myself. Granddad said it, you know, and a lot of old uncles have said it to me when I was a young fella, and I know it's going to happen. I know it's all true, but I sort of just, I don't want to think that way. That's not going to end, so... Yeah, it's about that respect and respect Mother Earth that we walk on, you know, and let her know that we do care for her. And there is a number of people out there, like ourselves, we do care and we do love her, we do respect her. But some other ignorant people out there that we've got to get through to.
Yes.
You know, and
but we have to reach them through inspiration. Yeah. You can't tell people what to think. You've got to sort of like, it's like you can take the horse to water, but you can't make it drink. You can give people the information, but you've got to... I think maybe this is the creative challenge that before us is to try to frame it all and present it in such a way that people are they're mystified by it and they go like, wow, this is so cool. How do we learn more about these awesome people in this beautiful, powerful land of Australia, and you know, and cut through all the bullshit and the generations of stereotypes and misinformation and denial and get the real story out there.
That's right, brother. And that's what my part of role has been, education, you know, culture officer here, based at Brambuck here, is promote that, you know, and I find it's hitting them young ones, you know, because their brain's a big sponge, you know. If we can hit them, it's going to be better, you know, the future's going to be better.
Yes.
I don't really care about the older ones, but that's their journey, but it's these young ones, they're the future, you know, and,
yes.
the generation after that. So we hit these young ones. It's going to be better.
Now you've talked about the importance of the rock art sites a lot in terms of getting the younger people involved with this. Do you think, would it be improper, like I'm not sure about how rock art was traditionally made, but would it be out of the question for new rock art to be created somewhere?
Yeah, a lot of my aunties actually say that too. I've got an auntie Tita, Tita Seacom, or Diane Seacom, and she's even... Her family, like she's my mum's first cousin, and her family, like her sons are that, my first cousins, they actually go out and they actually got their uncle's side here and got their hand stencils on there. So later in life, they actually bring their kids there, you know, and do the same thing, put their stencil there. So they are part of Mother Earth, you know, and they're keeping that old oral custom going. And that's why I sort of say with Parks Victoria, you know, we've got to keep this oral history and custom and laws going before it's too late, you know. And saying that rock art's very important, you know? If they can still do it up Central Desert, you know, why not down here, you know?
Absolutely.
Before it's too late, you know? And it comes to the government, you know, politics and Parks Victoria itself, you know, it's that lack of understanding and respect, but that's what I'm saying, is these young ones, we've got to hit the young ones, you know, and make them understand and realise, you know, that if we don't do it, there's going to be no stories, you know? Not for my community, but the non-Indigenous people as well, so...
Now, let me ask you this. So explain that Brambuk is actually a privately run organisation and it's not part of the government.
Yeah, that's where we're quite lucky here at Brambuk. We've lasted 22 years now. We actually opened December the 8th, 1990. Now, we are operated by ourselves, 100% owned by ourselves. There's no government funding, which is very good for us. Don't have to argue with the government every year. I don't know if you know, but here in Australia, the government are very tight with their money. So we are lucky that we are self-funded or 100% owned by ourselves. Now, we're Brambuk Aboriginal Culture Centre. We've been run for the five communities or the five tribes that represent the Brambuk Centre itself.
Will you name those?
So you've got the two clans that live in Gariwerd itself, with the Japonjali, which live in the northwest of Gariwerd, or known as the Grampians today. Also the Japrong that live in the southeast of the Gariwerd as well, or National Parks, or Grampians. Also you have the Wachabolic, on far northwest of the Wimmera Valley, up the Japarat sort of Horsham Dibola region. And also you have the Crip Jamara. They were taken to a missionary called Lake Conda, seen between Haywood, sort of Portland area. Then also you had the Gunajamara, were taken down to a missionary called Framlingham, which is down around the outskirts of Warrnambool. So we at Brambuk, we're actually being displayed from the five tribes or the five communities that operate the centre itself. So if you had a chance to come into the centre, you actually see the display throughout the building itself. These five clans or five tribes or the five communities are actually being displayed in the building itself. So the first one, this is the shape of the building, is represents the cockatoo, or the yellow crest cockatoo. It was a totem for the Japonjali and Japurung, or for Budja Budja or Gariwerd itself. So the building itself actually represents the cockatoo in flight. So upstairs you've got the old restaurant, the old cafes to be, got the funny shaped windows. Excuse me, it's a bit like going back to play school. Represents his beak opening up. Now we've actually got a feeder head here, and then that wing is our represents his right wing, where the feeder head is. The left wing is was known as a war room, or known as an art gallery. Now if you get a chance to come, you go around behind the building, what you'll notice, got a funny shaped big eye shaped window, represents the arch of his back, and also a funny shaped veranda represents his tail. So it is actually why cockatoo in flight was a totem for the Japonjali and the Japurung people, or Budja Budja or Gariwerd itself. Then also you've got the mud brick on the right hand side of the building. It's got the six windows in place, and also the fire drip. That's from a missionary called Ebenezer, where a lot of my ancestors were taken to back in the 18th century. It was actually the first missionary built here in Victoria. Don't know if you know, guys, if you live up with Ebenezer, it's actually built out of mud brick. So the church, the little school, the kitchen, little huts were built out of mud brick. But once this church started collapsing back in the late 80s, early 90s, a lot of the uncles and aunties went out there, some of this mud brick actually kept intact, never broke in half, brought down to the centre. Some has been regularly been made on site that represent the Ebenezer, or Wachabolic people, take to that missionary called Ebenezer. So we've got a bit of display represent the Wachabolic people. Also, you've got these big ironbark trees throughout the whole building itself, so at the front of the building, also in the building itself. And they represent the Gunajamara people, take to the missionary called Framlingham. And what the Gunajamara people tend to use these ironbark trees to build their humpies, or be known as housing today. So all these ironbark, most of them being stumped in Love and Hoppings River, being brought up here, the place in the building, to represent the Gunajamara people. Also, you've got the black stone, which is in the building itself, around the foyer part, around the fireplace, and halfway up that rampway. Now, that rampway going to the old cafeteria, their old restaurant, represents the Ill Dreaming, which was the Crip Jamara people were taken to a missionary called Lake Conda. So, all that black stone is actually what they use to farm or breed their eels. It's been brought from Lake Conda, a place to build and represent the Crip Jamara people. The last room is a big wild room, which represents the White Southern Wild. It represents pretty much the coast people, from the coast of Mornington, right across the coast, Torquay, Geelong, Warrnambool, Port, and Port Ferry. That represents the White Southern Whale. So if you had a chance coming to Brambuck, go into that room. It's called the Whale Room, or better as a gathering place.
What was the name for the whale?
I'm not 100% sure, brother. Okay. Yeah, but yeah, I might find out for you. But that room actually is shaped and designed exactly the same in the White Southern Whale's belly. So if you had a chance coming, go in that room, stand dead center of it, and look above you. That main beam represents his spine, and the other beam represents his rib cage.
So you're in the belly of the whale?
Yeah, the White Southern Whale, yeah. That's our view. These stars was like the song line, you know, it was originally came from here and went right far north of Australia, and it was all connected. It led us to water, you know, it led us to certain animals, certain birds, it led us to certain foods and that. So, and the ancestors have been doing it for thousands and thousands of years, and it's about the star dreaming, you know, just, the dreamtime story for the stars. It's all connected somehow. We had a whole story of these stories. And most of them, like some of the rock art, is all connected from here, the southern part, all the way to the NT of Australia. So. But no one could ever figure it out.
So we were talking about digging precious things from the land, and if we, the Hopi prophecy of Koyaanisqatsi, if we dig precious things from the land, we will invite disaster. And I was speculating that the guardian beings, the petroglyphs that we see at the beginning and ending of that movie, were sort of, they were put there to protect what's in the earth, and that bad things will they'll go out and actually cause bad things to happen if it's violated. And what were you saying about the protectors of the gold here?
There's an old story that's been passed on from generation to generation. Aunt didn't actually know the actual story from word for word, but she told us as young children that back in the the Wachabalik country is we've actually got two deserts there. We've got a big desert and a little desert up near Dimbola on the Rima River. It's called Horseshoe Bend. But just behind Horseshoe Bend, you've got the big desert and little desert, and there's a lot of stories passed from generation to generation. It's what we call known as Mim Mim Lights. Now, Mim Mim Lights was a spirit to protect the gold throughout that the two deserts there. And a lot of non-Indigenous people, they do try to go out there and look for this gold, but if they do come across this gold, they become very ill and become cursed. And like you're saying, it's these spirits being placed in Mother Earth, you know, we don't go nowhere near it. So with the Wachabalik and Wakaya people, my ancestors, northwest of Wimmera, that we never travelled through that country because the Mim Mim Lights were spirits and a very evil country. So, and like we were saying earlier on, that gold was useless to us. We had no purpose of using it, but white men, when they come to the material of gold, it was worth millions for them and thousands. And so we try to keep that story hidden, and but the Mim Mim Lights and whatnot. Now, I can't actually know the story off the top of my head, but Auntie Diane, or we're known as Auntie Titter, she actually knows the story word for word about the Mim Mim Lights and whatnot. And she actually does artwork about the Mim Mim Lights and try to tell people and
really?
Them and wear them.
Yeah, would she maybe let me film her sometime telling the story?
If you go to Horsham, Jeff, the best place probably to catch her is at Brindy Canyon. There's a land council in Horsham based mm-hmm. in Fibro Street. And her husband is Uncle Rez. He's very cultural awareness as well. And he knows a lot as well, Uncle Rez. And Auntie Tito, she probably knows more than Uncle Rez. Yeah, she's an amazing lady, and that's my mum's first cousin. So her mother and my grandmother, my mother's grandmother, were sisters. And there's a lot of stories that she knows and passed on. It's just mind-blowing. She's amazing.
That is so cool.
Yeah, and she actually wrote the book Mungrook. I don't know if you know about Mungrook here in Australia, but it's actually known as AFL today, football. And she's actually written a book that tells a story about Mungrook, how it was actually invented in football today, AFL football. And she's actually brought a book out at the start of this year. It is a kid's book, but she's got her own. She's a bit of an artist herself. She's got her own patterns.
Okay.
And she's got another lady to actually publish it. And it is pretty good, the Mungrook story, you know. And she's, if you get a chance to see her, she's pretty switched on. She knows what she's on about, and that culture side, you know. And that's what Titter means. It means sister in our language as well. Titter means sister. So,
Roony and Carla. You're so lucky to live in the most beautiful, powerful part of Australia, and I really want to thank you for your support and for having me here in Gariwerd and for all the beautiful energies you're contributing, the work you're doing and everything, and it's an awesome place.
You're welcome.
Thank you, my brother. I'd just like to leave you with two words, which is Barwook. Now, Barwook means goodbye or see you, and also Jambi, which means friend or mate. So Barwook Jambis. Thank you.
The kookaburras singing for us too.
Yes.